From the dark web to your radio dial, you are listening to Cyber Talk Radio on News 1200 WOAI.
Welcome to Cyber Talk Radio. I'm your host, Bret Piatt, a 20-year internet security veteran. I'm joined this week by the executive director of Project Quest, David Zammiello. David, thank you for joining us this week.
Hey, Bret, thanks for having us. Appreciate it very much.
Absolutely. So Project Quest here, is this athletic training to go run a marathon? Or give us the audience a little bit of background. Hint for those listening and really want to hear about cybersecurity and tech, it's got much more to do with that than training for a marathon.
Absolutely. Thanks for the question. You know, the idea with Quest, it has that kind of Olympic approach to it, if you think about it, but it really is around workforce development and training. So the organization's been around 25 years. Started in 1992 with the whole focus of trying to solve problems about how you put people to work and how you actually help people transition from jobs that maybe don't pay a living wage to putting them to work in jobs that pay a living wage. And so for the last 25 years, Quest provides a unique set of wraparound services. I mean, we take people that are in the unemployed, underemployed segment of our community, gather services and have an opportunity to find work through certifications in IT space or in the healthcare space, and put them in situations where they can acquire living wage type jobs.
Yeah, and I think for those listening out there and thinking, maybe you're driving home from a job and going, you know what, I can never get into this technology stuff. I can never get into cybersecurity. It's not for me. Not true. The cybersecurity and technology is not just for people that got a perfect SAT score and went to an Ivy League school. Cybersecurity is for anyone that wants to go in and apply themselves to learn problem solving and to you're going to just like learning for whatever job you're driving home from right now while you're listening on 1200 WAI. That job required you to learn a set of things in order to be able to do that. Cybersecurity and the technology jobs or Project Quest maybe started back doing aircraft maintenance repair, or where did it initially get its funding?
Its core services around the healthcare industry. So a lot of the nursing, the LVNs, RNs type jobs, and that was really the beginning of it. If you think about at that time, there was a lot of manufacturing jobs here in the community. Those jobs started to evaporate in the early 90s. So with the support of organizations like the City of San Antonio, COPS Metro, and other businessmen, we created this entity called Quest to help people transition from these jobs where they actually left San Antonio to jobs that would be more relevant to this economy of the future. And so that is where Quest started, and that whole idea of putting people to work has been the basis for Quest. And over the last 3 years in particular, getting back to what your audience may be interested in, you're right, accessibility to the training to provide those kind of jobs, the last 3 or 4 years, Quest has emphasized offering programs through Open Cloud Academy to give people the chances to gain various certifications and skills to get these type of high-paying jobs.
Yeah, so if you're hearing about Open Cloud Academy for the first time, we've had Deborah Carter, the director of that, on here. You can listen to the rebroadcast and replay of that program with Deborah, where she talks all about Open Cloud Academy on our podcast via iTunes or Pocket Casts on an Android device. You can also look everything up on our website at www.cybertalkradio.com. But on the Quest partnership with Open Cloud Academy there, my understanding on that one is that y'all will help out with about half of the tuition cost for Open Cloud.
Absolutely. And just to elaborate for a second, we have a very robust relationship with Open Cloud Academy. We last year, between Quest and OCA, we graduated over 200 people that had various certifications. In particular, the three classes that we've offered through OCA was a network operations class, which allows us to then get the Cisco Certified Network Associate, the CCNA, if you would. In addition to that, the Linux Administration course, resulting in the Red Hat Certified Systems Administrator, which is the RHCSA, and then our cyber programs, which we have candidates that come out and they test for the Compass Security Plus, or SEC Plus, and the Cyber Security Information Systems Security Professional, the CISSP. And that has been a very, very productive relationship with Deborah and Open Cloud Academy. And what's really interesting about that is, as we recruit for that, it also allows us to reach out to our military personnel. So those types of roles, as you would imagine, having certain types of security clearances are attractive to that skills, and it allows people to step into the program. And it's a very rigorous program for 11 weeks, but it gives us a chance to also provide vets an opportunity to get these type of jobs.
Yeah, and it's especially in this community, we have hundreds of folks that retire from active duty here every month in San Antonio, and they're not really ready to retire. And they may have skills that they've gained in their years of service mm-hmm. for the country, but they don't have recognized private sector certifications. This happened on the healthcare side as well. In the military, you would go in and become a nurse in the military, but you wouldn't have an RN or an LVN certification that would transfer to the private sector. The same thing happens in the technology world, where you could be a certified network cyber analyst inside, but that doesn't give you a Security Plus equivalent when you get out. So programs like Open Cloud Academy and your partnership there, that's 11 weeks, can allow folks to make that transition much more quickly. They don't have to get out and go to a 2-year or 4-year program in order to be able to go back into the workforce.
That's right. And I think the important part there is, for your listeners, that Quest itself doesn't do the training. Quest, through various partnerships, so Open Cloud Academy certainly is one of our key partners in this space, but we also partner with CodeUp here in San Antonio and the San Antonio Coding Academy. And so our strategy, if you would, our we serve as an intermediary to take the trainers that provide the certifications and match them up with the individuals who are looking for those particular types of skills. OCA just has the more robust relationship right now and does a great job for us.
Yeah, and if you're in our active duty or retired military and you're listening and thinking about some of these things, CodeUp is also GI Bill eligible there. So if you've got dollars available to you, you can go on that and get into software development through a very intensive multi-month program there. But again, it's not having to go for multiple years to be able to get new skills or get an industry private sector recognized certification to be able to go take those skills and show an employer on the private sector side that you're qualified and ready for a role.
And individuals that may are considering this, if they come out to our website, they can see our offerings on that. But the other thing I think is really important to note, that the 3 or 4 that we just talked about, there is your 2-year associate's degrees that you get through St. Philip's and you get through the San Antonio College. So again, our partnerships are very robust and will help fit the individual to whatever program meets their particular needs, and whether it's OCA or CodeUp or one of the Alamo Community Colleges. And so our job is to support them through that process, so your listeners can take this as a way. There's options, and so if there's something that you want to pursue, there's many different ways we can help you reach your goals.
Yeah, and this is it's all about accessibility and helping the folks make those transitions. So you mentioned a Project Quest website. If they've been hanging out listening here on their drive home for a moment.
Yes, it is at www.questsa.org.
Yeah.
And pop over, take a look.
Yeah, and if you put into your search engine bar Project Quest San Antonio, it's going to show up somewhere there near the top. And if not, click on the real link so that we can help train the search engines better so it does show up that way. So you said that the organization's been around for 25 years. So, David, how long have you been involved, and how did you start your journey there with Project Quest?
It's a fascinating story there. I've been with Quest a whopping 5 weeks right now. And to kind of back up for a second, a little bit of my background of how I came here and why I'm at Quest and why we're having this conversation today is I spent 32 years at USAA, last 20 as an executive, retired in December of 2016, with the idea of doing something like this. My background at USAA spanned a couple of different disciplines. One was IT. So in my early days as in IT, I spent time as an IT architect, as a database designer. The last part of my time there was in system security, that we called that back in the late 80s, early 90s, and actually had a stint in a role where we were writing access rules for data mainframe, which was ACF2 and RACF type work, and doing physical and data security control processes. So I had a little bit of that time, and then right when the industry took off and went to distributed processing, I stepped out of IT. So spent about 10 years in the technical side of the business, had a middle part of the career there that I was in human resources, and that was more recruiting, talent management, workforce planning. So I had a background in that. And when I decided to retire from USAA, I had the idea that I was going to take some time off, but work at some point down the road. That lasted about 3 or 4 months, and in March of this past year, I was approached about Quest and asked if I would be interested in looking at the opportunity. To be honest, at that time, I had not heard of Quest. I didn't know what Quest did, which was to my surprise, and said, let me look into it. And as I got a little more familiar with the mission, the background, So I really became intrigued by what they do for the things we're talking about today, giving people opportunities to change their lives and go to work. And so with my background from a technical standpoint, along from a human resources standpoint, went through the process, and on June 26th, I showed up for the first time on the job. And like I said, 5 weeks into it, and I certainly couldn't be happier. I think the challenge, the needs of our community need organizations like Quest doing what they do. And I think some of the programs and the way we're doing things, there's opportunities to further scale and take this to a whole different level. And you know, I think Quest has a lot to be proud of over the last 25 years of what it's done for our community, especially with the support of the city and COPS Metro and other organizations. And now, as we know, the economy has changed and the type of jobs that are out there. And we see San Antonio is certainly a hotbed for IT and for cyber type jobs. The demand is certainly outpacing the supply, and organizations like Quest are trying to step into the breach with other partners and say, how do you create different channels to deliver this talent to these organizations that need that kind of skill set?
Yeah. So you're listening to 1200 WAI. This is Cyber Talk Radio. I'm your host, and I'm joined this week by David Zammiello, the executive director of Project Quest. If you've just tuned in, you can catch the rebroadcast and replay of this full program on Tuesday. We will post it online on our website on www.cybertalkradio.com. David's covered the overview and background of Project Quest starting here 25 years ago to help develop talent in the San Antonio area, to help folks from all education levels and all backgrounds get into jobs that pay a living wage, that can allow you to raise a family and enjoy your life here in our great city of San Antonio. Specifically, just before that, you were talking to me about these cyber jobs, and this is one that's come up here a number of times as we focus on that industry here with this program. There's somewhere between 300,000 and 500,000 jobs posted out across the U.S. right now on cyber, and my real belief on that is that there's more like 2 million or 3 million job openings that the other folks are just not posting them because they know they can't actually even get someone to fill it. Mm-hmm. And this is one just where we're still at the beginning of this cyber curve. If you go out there across America to small businesses, there's things like HIPAA, which has started to ask doctors to put medical records into digital formats. If you go to your local doctor's office, chances are you're still going to see that big wall of folders there. So as all of these businesses need to move from paper records, and they even have regulatory mandates to go do it, there's not the staff or the people, so they just keep going back. The different trade associations are telling the regulatory bodies in many cases, like, we can't actually make this happen. And this is all the way down to an individual doctor's office, all the way up to the hospitals on the healthcare side of things. It's just not feasible because there isn't the workforce available to make the transition in a safe and secure manner right now. So as all of these paper records and all of our paper business processes move into technology-based services, the number of jobs keeping things safe, writing those access control lists, managing that, dealing with all of the exceptions and things that come up every day, is like everyone likes to think of there's a way to make every process consistent and normal. And maybe if you're Toyota down at the plant and you're running the same truck off an assembly line, you can. But as soon as you get out into many business processes, they're never going to be that clean and refined. And there's going to be roles in these cyber jobs for at least the next 20 years or 30 years, 50 years probably, as we think at the evolution and pace of industries.
Absolutely. And I think the thing that from a Quest standpoint is really trying to understand and clarify that demand, because as you know, you just said, this cuts across many different industries, so it's not focusing strictly on what's the cyber demand from a financial services industry or a banking industry or a manufacturing industry. It's across the board there. And I think one of the opportunities for us to get better, and especially locally, is to better understand what those demand jobs look like so we can quantify them. And then if I use the term, then work backwards to make sure our pipeline is robust enough so the talent is arriving at the right pace to meet those demands. And as I look at this, I think there's still an opportunity for that. But if there's organizations that are certainly looking to fill jobs, they should contact us, take a look at what we're doing, because we've just finished our third cohort and class group. We've had great success. We'll probably produce with each class, give or take, 14, 15, or 16 graduates that are ready to hit the ground running. We just finished up our third cohort group. And so there's opportunities that if an employer's out there looking, maybe they haven't been creative to think, where do I go find this particular talent? This is another channel that maybe is off the traditional path to find the talent. And it helps us better get an understanding of what those target demands are. We can work back. We intend in 2018 to certainly open the aperture up with our partnership, as I said, with OCA and others, and bring more classes to the forefront. And with each class, we're producing anywhere from 18 or so, as I said. But that's just one part. And I think that if we can better understand demand across these industries, we can do a better job of matching supply up there, because I think the talent is there, especially as organizations like the military continue to transition. There's going to be talent for those individuals looking for these opportunities, and we have a nice fit. But there's work to be done. I wouldn't kid you. You're right. The demand curve is going up. Supply is definitely not keeping pace with that. And we're trying to step into that breach and say, how do you better mitigate some of that?
Yeah, so if you have projects on hold, if you haven't posted a job because you were like, yeah, I could put an ad up, but I'm never going to get the right candidate, here's a chance to proactively go out and from a recruiting and an HR and a leadership perspective at your business to build a relationship with Project Quest. Let them know what skills and knowledge and processes that folks need to be able to do to for you to employ them. And then this is your chance to have a talent and workforce development arm out there for you as a business, for you as a business community, to fill those roles so that you're not posting jobs and waiting for 6 months to get the right candidate and having your business growth stall because you can't take on new projects for potential clients and all the things that happen when you don't have the people available inside of your company that you need to execute.
As a matter of fact, if any of your listeners are really in that mode right now, we have what we're calling a meet and greet coming up on August 30th. They can go to that website that I mentioned earlier for the Quest website to find a location. And we have about 10 or 12 individuals that are ready to roll right now and step into jobs. And that's our third cohort group. So we have talent out there that if you're interested, we certainly would want to have that conversation with you.
Going out to work with Project Quest, if I'm an employer, what fees do you charge me? Do you charge me per person you sign up? Or how does this whole relationship as an employer, if I'm going to contact Project Quest, how does that work?
You know, Brett, the unique thing is there's no fees involved with this. If you think about it, you'll find some search companies that there's a fee base. But the thing about Quest is we're producing the talent, putting them to work. So if you have an employer that's looking for an opportunity, we have the talent, and it's no fees based at all right now. And you know, while I'm thinking about that, we've had great partnerships with many employers here in the community, and so we're very thankful for the work and support that we've gotten from the USAAs of the world, from CPS, from the 22nd Century Technology Company, IP Secure, Rackspace. They've benefited from our graduates, and I think they would provide a good testimonial to the type of talent that's being produced through our various classes. And again, the beautiful thing is that if an employer is looking for that kind of talent, they can have access to it and not have any additional fees associated with it.
Yeah, I know in my time as an executive at Rackspace, we hired many folks that went through Project Quest backed training programs into the division that I ran there. So on the current curriculum for Project Quest, so you've got these cyber programs in boot camp, but we are on just general AM radio here. Well, as we'll be out on the internet on iHeart, but also back on podcasts and things in the future for replays. But for those listening out there, if they're interested in back to your start at Project Quest in an LVN or RN, is Project Quest still helping folks get those type of certifications in the healthcare space?
Yes, that particular industry is our cornerstone. And as I mentioned earlier, that's really where Quest had its impact over the last 25 years. But as we looked at the changing landscape of the marketplace and demand, the last 3 or 4 years, we started to shift some of our focus to the IT space in general and cybersecurity. That was really triggered. If we go back a little bit, we received a grant from the Department of Labor. It was referred to as the DOL IT grant. And that grant gave us the funding resources to really develop the program that we're talking about today. And that's a key thing about how Quest does its business, that we do have a dependency and reliance on investors, if you would, who want to offer us. And so the city of San Antonio has been a great supporter of Quest through its investments, along with our county, and as I said just now, our Department of Labor. And that funding allowed us to really create the program that we're talking about today and allow us to have the opportunity to serve those participants that I'm talking about.
Yeah, so you have some public sector funding. Do you have private sector funding as well?
Yes, we do. But that is still a work in progress for us. I think as we've gone forward and we look at the opportunities to scale Quest services, the idea of bringing other business partners into our fold is an objective for us. And again, we're very grateful and thankful for all the public sector funding that we've had. But I think the business community is starting to take note of these opportunities. And part of our going forward proposition is to show them the return on investment and bring them in to help support the programs.
Yeah, well, and if they're getting their money matched with some public sector dollars, it helps their money go further. So if you were a private sector foundation or you're an employer out here that wants to contribute to Project Quest, do you have any activities coming up the second half of this year where they can reach out and get involved?
Yeah, there is. This is our 25th silver anniversary. So Quest was, as I said, actually July was our official birthday. Our main event, if you would, is coming up this November 8th, and we're having a luncheon downtown at the Grand Hyatt. Our mayor, Ron Nirenberg, is graciously given his time to be part of that and support the program, and I think his belief around workforce and economic development, he wants to offer his words of support. So November 8th at the Grand Hyatt, again, you go back to our website and you can find the information about that. We'll be getting to socialize that more on various social media platforms. And that becomes an opportunity for the business community and for all walks of their community to come together and take time out to look at what Quest has done and to then allow a chance to show what we want to do going forward and really solicit some of the support that we're talking about. And that's a big deal for us. And so we're very excited about that coming up. And I think there's an opportunity there for folks that maybe aren't as familiar with Quest to have a chance to take a look at us.
We're getting ready here to head into the bottom of the hour break for news, traffic, and weather. If you've recently tuned in on the dial, you're listening to Cyber Talk Radio. I'm the host, Bret Piatt. I'm here joined this week by David Zammiello, the executive director of Project Quest. They're helping develop our cyber workforce here in the greater San Antonio area. In the first half of the program, covered a big overview of their history. This is their 25th year, and they've not been doing cyber the whole time, but it's one of the programs now over the last few years that's really starting to ramp up for them as the economy and jobs are starting to change. In the second half of this program, after the break, you'll be able to hear all the details of the different background skills qualifications they're looking for, as well as then what happens in each of the different programs so that you can go from where you are today, maybe working in a retail job in a big box store, thinking about, man, I really would love to have a career in IT and technology and cybersecurity. And through Project Quest and the educational options they've got, those things can happen for you. You're listening to 1200 WAI. We will be right back. Welcome back to Cyber Talk Radio. I'm your host, Bret Piatt, a 20-year internet security veteran. I'm joined this week by David Zammiello, the executive director of Project Quest. If you are joining us here after that news traffic and weather update, again, thank you, David, for coming out and joining us here on Cyber Talk Radio.
You bet.
So we had promised the folks there before the break, if they hung around with us, that we were going to deep dive into what does this curriculum look like. And if you go to questsa.org and you learn about these and you apply for one and get accepted into one of these programs, what will you be doing?
You know, I think that as I kind of walk you through that answer there, it's important to take a step back and look at the boot camp itself. So the cyber boot camp, the origin around that whole boot camp was when the need was established, that there was an opportunity to look at these different type of jobs. The collaboration and partnership with Rackspace, with USAA, and with eventually Open Cloud Academy was where the whole idea became evident that we needed some work. And that collaborative effort really resulted in what we're calling the cyber curriculum, and then looking to Open Cloud Academy to be the vehicle to deliver that. So a shout out to the original folks who really gave the thought about what is the kind of content that goes into this boot camp. The boot camp itself is 11 weeks long. It's a very rigorous course, and we talked about earlier in the program the type of individuals that would fit in this kind of program. Because of the nature of the work, those in the military that have security clearances are attractive to the program, but we don't recruit exclusively for those type of individuals. Anyone who has a background in IT and has the desire to learn about these particular programs is welcome to come into our recruitment process. We'll say this, though, from the recruitment standpoint, we do look, as I said, for the security clearance, not a showstopper, but also an individual's depth around their own IT or cyber experience. And then as any other job background check would be, making sure they meet the qualifications and have the background to then actually go into the program. So that sets up, you know, the whole context of what the cyber program is about. When you get into the curriculum itself, and as we put people in and we do a very rigorous assessment, we're looking at, do they have Compta, Net Plus, or Net Plus equivalent, and to be admitted in the class. And also what's important to note is if you don't, Open Cloud Academy does offer these free classes to get that prerequisite, if you will, before you step into the course. The boot camp curriculum itself, though, is a combination of cybersecurity fundamentals, cybersecurity for network security administration, IT auditor and risk management. We have an element of the program around ethical hacking, penetration testing, and securing wireless networks. And as a result of going through those 11 weeks, an individual coming out of the program will also receive the certification of Security Plus and the CISSP, which are both very successful parts of the program.
Yeah, and so as David's saying that these are industry relevant certifications, that's true for certain. So going back in my history, I started off getting a CCNA, a Cisco Certified Network Associate certification. To date myself a little bit, when I got that Cisco Certified Network Associate, they sent you a T-shirt along with your certificate. So this was, I think they made 10,000 of these T-shirts for the first 10,000 people to go get that CCNA certification. And then when I received my CISSP, I was right on the cutoff cusp. So initially, the CISSP, the first really early group, and some of my friends that I colleagues that I'd worked with, they sent it on a wood lacquered plaque. Was your CISSP came like a college graduation certificate, and I got mine a few months because they offered the test I think two or three times a year back then, and I received mine just after that, and it came in like a nice high school graduation style kind of folio, a leather folio, and then inside there was a certificate, and then we had some folks that took it again about a year later, and by that point it was in a FedEx style photo envelope of like, please don't bend this, but no more folio, no more lacquered plaque, as the CISSP really from back in the early 2000s grew up into this solid proof that you knew a wide variety of security domains, because one of the things we were talking about a little bit off the air during our break was cybersecurity is a huge domain. Like if you go into NIST and you look at how they define cybersecurity and they define all the jobs and roles for cybersecurity, it's not just one things like if you're watching Mr. Robot on TV or you've watched Hackers, the movie, or these things. There's a very wide variety of roles in cybersecurity, all the way from hands-on technical penetration testing and security pieces, but through to policy planning, process, risk management, risk prevention. All of these tie into a cyber team, and you have to have all the members of a team across all of those domains in order to build a successful cyber organization. Just like any other team and organization, it's not just all about one role or one person.
You know, what's funny about that, or interesting about that, is dating myself back to when I came into this industry back in the mid-80s, I was so proud when I received what we called the CCP back then. I was a certified computing professional, and it had elements of the things we're talking about today, but it was so general in nature, and the skill sets required today, as you said, the specialization because of what's going on, is so critical to successfully kind of running the business, and I think that's where, again, our programs allow that specialization to take place and build a portfolio of skills to deal with the challenges of today's IT space.
Yeah. So for the general programs with the Open Cloud Academy, if you're there and you're working with Project Quest, that one's a tuition sharing. But on this cyber program that they can go to questsa.org and apply for, my understanding, you get into this program, it's a full 100% paid scholarship.
That's exactly right, Brett. It's a full scholarship. And as we were talking about the top of the program, in addition to the cyber, the two broader IT programs around the network operations class, which gives you the certification for your CCNA, or the other one for the Red Hat certified. Those are tuition shared programs in addition to what we're talking about cyber, but cyber is a full tuition based program.
Yeah. So you get into this program and you're going for 11 weeks. And you said you cover this wide variety of content over that course of 11 weeks. So I know you guys also do some work with some of the community colleges and Alamo area community colleges here. From a comparison for folks to understand, this 11 weeks, is that one semester worth of normal, like taking one credit hour, or is that like really the 11 weeks is kind of the equivalent of a full class load?
That's the way I would actually equate it to. The 11 weeks and what you come out to is comparable to, in some cases, what you may get from your full associates. I mean, broader from the associate's degree, but the workload itself is pretty rigorous and pretty intense. So if you're carrying a full load in the semester, let's call it 15, 18 hours, it's probably very similar to it, but it's compressed, it's intense. You have to be really focused if you're going to get into the program. And we try to prepare our recruits that says, if you're going to step into this, you really have to be prepared to put the time and effort into it to be successful. And that's why the assessment piece on the front end, to make sure that individuals really have an understanding of it. What's also important to note is we're talking about this from a technical perspective, but what also runs parallel to that is the work we do with our participants to make sure they are ready for the job market. So there's an element of soft skills training that goes on, job preparation, resume writing, and doing the things that allow them to not just be technically proficient and ready to roll into the marketplace, but have the interpersonal skills, if you would, to help them sell their services and skills to potential employers. And while I'm thinking about it, we talked about potential employers earlier. So for your listeners, if you do have those jobs that we were talking about earlier, I'm going to give you a quick inside tip. If you will write to Susan O at QuestSA.org, again, Susan O at QuestSA.org, and you have a particular job that you're looking to fill, or you have a particular idea you want to share about your particular needs, if you'll write Susan, she is focused on this particular topic, and we'll make sure she gets back to you. And we'll take all kinds of input. I mean, it takes many different ideas to help solve the problem here. We're trying to collect all those. So again, Susan O at QuestSA.org. You'll be doing us a great favor. We'd appreciate that.
Yeah. And they can't develop the right programs if they don't get the right feedback. So please, yeah, let them know if you're like saying, you know what, that piece about the ethical hacking, we need you to double down on that, and we need the folks coming out not with a Security Plus, but they need to come out with a certified ethical hacker certification. If that's the case, and that would be more helpful to you for the skills and roles you're looking to hire, maybe if you're running a group that's doing some of the offensive cyber activities, that there are missions around that, either for penetration testing, so people having their own organization hacked by people that are ethical, so the good guys can find the flaws before the bad guys do, or if you're on an offensive cyber mission as part of our Department of Defense.
And the other part I would add to that is help us look ahead. The industry is changing so much, and those folks on the front line certainly have a better appreciation for the type of things we're talking about here, but also looking ahead a little bit, giving us a chance to anticipate what those particular needs would be, because we certainly have the capability to then customize curriculum through our various partners to help meet those particular demands. And that's where the whole thing comes full circle, that if we can partner like that and gather those requirements, it'll allow us to be better to set up those training programs to meet those needs. But looking ahead is really important, that we certainly could benefit from that.
Yeah. So this 11 weeks is all day, every day, or night classes? How does that work during that 11-week program?
It is just like you're going to a full-time job. I mean, it is literally an all-day proposition that you're there for your 8 or 10 hours, and there is homework to be done and side projects to be done. So it's a fully committed proposition here, just like you're working and going to school. It's something you just got to stay with. And it's, again, a very intense 11 weeks that you have to be all in.
Yeah, so block off your calendars. Watch all those episodes of your favorite TV show before the 11 weeks starts, or save them up until after it's done. But during that 11-week period, to get through and get all the information in and processed, and then to be able to pass those tests at the end, it's one where I recommend, as David is saying, to go through and really spend that time and spend the hours you have there with access to the facilities, with access to the instructors, with access to your peer group in group learning to take advantage of that fully.
And Brett, the other thing I'd say to that, that's exactly right, but the other part about working with our participants to look ahead for their job prospects, I can tell you we've completed three full classes. Actually, we've completed two, the third's about to graduate in September 1st. And so if you think about it from this standpoint, our first class, we had 13 graduates. 11 of those were employed coming right out of class, and that was very successful. They landed in organizations like IP Secure, CPS Energy, Rackspace, USAA. Our second class had 14 graduates. They just graduated in mid-June, and 11 were employed, and a few are in process. So you can see our placement rate is extremely successful. And the class that we mentioned earlier, our third class, is going to graduate here in September. And if you have employers out there that are interested in looking for those particular skills, as I mentioned, we have a meet and greet coming up on August 30th to look at that particular talent. But the placement rates, and I will tell you that from a compensation standpoint, we talked about living wages. There certainly is a marketplace that would make this a very lucrative, if you would, opportunity from a job standpoint to take care of your families. And certainly those companies are paying very well for those positions.
Yeah, have any of your employers released the average salary data yet?
Not that I've seen. Probably wouldn't be something I would talk about on the radio here
today. Yeah, I mean, I'll say, as an employer here in this market, for folks with the qualifications and skills coming out of there, there's a very good chance, even if this is your first real full-time IT job, if you're learning these skills and transitioning in, that you're going to be making above the median salary in San Antonio as an individual. And as you progress in this, folks with a CISSP, the full certification, and the 3 years in order to get fully certified as a CISSP and not just a CISSP mm-hmm. associate, most of those folks are making in the six-figure range.
And I'll elaborate. When you think about our cornerstone services around the healthcare industry with our nursing profession, most individuals that complete those programs will experience somewhere in the neighborhood of over 280% increase in their salary from where they were pre-Quest to post-Quest. I can say in our cyber programs and IT programs, the transition from what your compensation was coming out of the program is, as you said, even higher than that.
Yeah, no, and this is one as well. You're not only moving into a job, I believe, that has good pay, good, fun, creative work, can be challenging and stressful at times, just like everything else, but also has a long career trajectory ahead of it as technology is changing many industries. And we talked about this a little bit, maybe this may have been off air as well, just about healthcare and digital medical records going into healthcare. And with that, every healthcare provider is going to need to have people that understand cybersecurity so that they can keep the digital medical records safe and secure. Because mm-hmm. Moving from those paper files that we all see when we walk into the doctor's office to digital records creates a whole new set of risks for each of those doctor's offices, medical groups or hospitals to have to deal with to keep all of our confidential and private information as individuals in that healthcare system safe.
Yeah, it's one thing to note that part of what drives Quest focus is the term demand occupation. So we have a chance to work with other organizations to say what are the key demand occupations, and we drive our resources to build pipelines to meet those particular needs. And it's safe to say that in the IT and cyber space, from a demand occupation standpoint, as we talked about the hundreds of thousands of jobs, that is the leading trending demand occupation out there. And as we said, we probably could not do enough to meet those needs. But that's where Quest focuses on what does the businesses need, and IT cyber certainly has shown it in the last 4 years to be the key demand occupation.
Yeah, I mean, we have over 100 cybersecurity companies headquartered in San Antonio, and many of them work for the Department of Defense as a private company contracting for them. IP Secure, we've had some of the folks from there on the program before. If you want to learn a little bit more about them, you can go to www.cybertalkradio.com, or you can look up on iTunes podcasts, Pocket Cast on your Android device, or our YouTube channel as well. And you can learn some more about some of the cyber companies that are headquartered here in San Antonio. You don't necessarily see them with big signs along the freeway. You've got large employers that have large IT security teams like a USAA, and you see them, or a Rackspace on I-35 or I-10 here in the area. But all of these other companies that are spread out all across town are looking for folks with these cyber skills, and as they're able to add people with the skills like a Project Quest program can give them, it gives those companies an opportunity to go grow their business and acquire more customers and do more to help businesses out there that won't employ their own full-time cyber staff themselves.
And that's what makes this a little bit of a unique conversation, because you can look at certain industries and you can kind of fence off and say this is a banking industry job, that is, but in the IT cyberspace, it cuts across all those different industries, which makes it in some ways challenging to peg what's the actual demand unless you work horizontally and really kind of tap into these various employers, which we try to do to better understand, you know, what that demand is. And you can't look at just one particular industry and say what I need, because it cuts across all these different businesses.
Yeah, I mean, name an industry now that's not using computers. Yeah, we're gonna have a lot of dead air. There's not gonna be much of a conversation there. I mean, there's a startup here in San Antonio that's working on doing computer-based routing of dump trucks. So, like, even getting into big, heavy physical machinery, that type of stuff is moving off of paper clipboards and paper scheduling into real-time managed software networks with technology built by companies like Dauber and others. So this is, you go into, there's another startup here, like, looking at the cattle industry and cattle auctions. So, like, all the way down into ranching, into construction, into everything, cybersecurity and technologies going to impact all of that.
Absolutely. And I think that the other piece of that is that right now, as we're speaking and talking on the program today, that what the whole cyber program has done, we're recruiting as we speak. So I think that's important for your listeners to understand. We've talked about the curriculum. We've talked about getting into the program. But we probably haven't hit enough on the fact that as we speak right now, we are actively recruiting. And so if you are in one of those particular businesses that we were talking about earlier, have an interest in it, please look us up, because we're ready to kind of get that next class going, and we have a strong demand. So we certainly want to reach out and have individuals that have that interest be aware of us and work with us.
Yeah. So you're listening to Cyber Talk Radio on 1200 WAI. If you are just joining us now on the program, you can catch the rebroadcast of this on iTunes Podcast, Pocket Casts, or on our YouTube channel on the Tuesday after we've aired this program. You can also catch past programs. So if you've never heard of a drop test, if you don't know what one is, you can look that up and hear a great story from Tom Desott as he goes through some of the human hacking and social engineering side of things, and all the tricks that hackers will try to pull to get into different organizations' computer systems. And these are the things that you'll learn in a Project Quest cyber camp. It's not necessarily just about how to configure all the technical things. It's you also have to learn a little bit to think like the hacker so that you do know which technical things to configure and how and what to go look for. So, David, I know you had mentioned that, and we had talked that this Project Quest-backed cyber boot camp, it's 11-week technical certification and training program, is 100% paid. So the folks that get in, it's a scholarship to this program. Where they don't have any tuition or books or any upfront fees. They need to be able to show up and go all day, every day for 11 weeks. But these type of programs and classes that I've seen offered elsewhere are in the $10,000 plus range.
Yeah, it's definitely a significant investment financially. And so our participants who are fortunate enough to get in the program, it's the equivalent of receiving a scholarship to the tune of $15,000-$16,000 to help them get through the program. And so it's not insignificant, and so certainly the benefit, but I think the trade-off is the intensity of the program, the investment on the back end. You're getting a chance to do the creative work you're talking about, important work, but also have an opportunity to have a very lucrative career.
Yeah. So, yeah, for those of you thinking about applying for this, or if you're thinking about, like, what am I really getting? Am I getting a great value if I do get into this program? Or is this something that I could have just gone and paid $500 and gone to something like some online learning camp myself online? That's not what this is. This is a very high-quality program with amazing instructors. Some of the folks I know, we've had some folks from Open Cloud Academy on the program before. They've won Teacher of the Year before. They've gone into technical training and certification. So these are folks that know technical training up at Open Cloud, but they also just know education curriculum and all sorts of broad background into cyber and into how to teach folks and help you as a student in the program really learn. And we all know the quality of the educator that you're working with really drives the student outcomes inside of a program. And these are world-class teachers. I think we're really thankful to have them here in San Antonio and be able to have programs like this cyber boot camp with Project Quest backing to keep them here and to have them teaching folks that are lucky enough to get in.
And the other thing is that, as you said, it's a hands-on experience. So there's not any distance type learning or online. I mean, you're going to be in the classroom with those instructors, and they're going to be coaching all the way through it. And so the time investment that they're making, for those that are interested, is you're in the class, you're being coached by those experts, but it's hands-on, on the ground, being involved with it.
Yeah, I mean, I believe in the program enough myself, not on the cyber one, but my son went through the network ops program up at Open Cloud Academy. He's working in the tech industry here in San Antonio now himself.
And so I think as we kind of think about what's next for Quest and all this, I can't emphasize enough employer involvement. And as we kind of think about what's going to happen going into our next year, is the more employer involvement that we can get. And we've had great support from the Rackspace in USA and other organizations. If you're out there listening and you're one of those employers and you've got an idea, I can't stress enough that we would certainly value from having your input into our process, how to further this program. And then the other thing is, there's other ways to get involved. We have our major event coming up on November 8th, which is our annual luncheon. I mentioned that earlier. But from providing the financial support for Quest to continue to expand the programs, I would certainly encourage your listeners and those to take a note of that, find out more information about that. And certainly if you have the opportunity, come on down, join us on November 8th. I think there's a lot to learn. You'll see the program, and we'd certainly appreciate the financial investments to help us continue to expand the programs.
Yeah. Come hear our new mayor, Ron Nirenberg, talk about workforce development and talk about Project Quest and about workforce development. And probably with this 25 years of success for Project Quest helping our community really keep up with building and growing in key industries.
So, Brett, just want to tell you thank you guys for the opportunity to spend some time telling our story. Hopefully your listeners found some value and made it informative, but we appreciate the opportunity to share. Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining us this week, and look forward to getting you at least one student in your next cohort out of our listening audience.
Awesome. Thanks, man.